Undersecretary of Health, and the Republicans voted him down because he was too liberal in his policies on health care reform. But John and I became friends, and it just so happened that he was one of the founding stockholders of a group that took over the operation of the ABC station in Boston in the early 1970s. And because of his input, the station decided to do a little half-hour health program in the morning called House Call. And John asked me to host it as a personal favor to him, and I said, that seems a little strange, but I agreed to try it for 2 months and see how it went. So I'd do this little program in the morning for a half an hour and then go to the hospital the rest of the day. And that led to some more programming, and when Good Morning, we can't see anybody. When Good Morning America started in 1975, they asked me to join them, which I did. And I kept doing stuff for them over the next 9 years. And finally, in 1984, I went full-time with ABC News as their so-called medical editor and remained in that position for 25 years until I retired in 2009. Along the way, I also got very involved with Harvard Medical School through several connections and friends, and at one point spent a year as a fellow in the Department of Continuing Education. And in that capacity, I started something called the Harvard Medical School Health Letter, which was the first health letter of its kind at that time. And I remember the experience for many reasons, but one of them you would all relate to, I think, and smile about. So when we came up with the idea of starting this health letter and using the Harvard name to send it out to the general public, we thought we ought to go talk to the dean about it, of course, and the dean then was a man named Bob Ebert. So my colleague and I went in to see Bob Ebert in his office, and we told him we wanted to start this health letter with the Harvard name, and he sat there kind of like this for, it seemed like many, many minutes, probably 30 seconds, and then he looked at me and says, do it. Can you imagine that happening today? No faculty committee, no study. If they'd have done that, it would have been killed for sure, but because he just liked the idea and he said, do it, we did, and it took off and became a very successful first health letter, and we had a lot of fun with that. And along the way at that time, as I was doing more writing and wrote the health letter every month and was doing more television work for ABC, I really felt the need to brush up on epidemiology and biostatistics, because as we all recall, we got very little of that in our standard medical school training at that time. And it just happened that my office at the medical school was right next door to the Harvard School of Public Health. So I was able, over a two-year period, part-time, to get a master's in public health in biostatistics and epidemiology. And that proved to be extremely helpful to me as I was more and more in the spot of having to evaluate studies and report on them to the public in the various modes that I describe. So when I first became full-time medical editor for ABC News in 1984, my very first episode as the newly minted medical editor is one I'm going to show you now. And I'll set the stage. I was in New York. It was in the fall of 1984. I'd just been on that job for a couple of weeks. I was actually in New York working on my first 2020 report when I got a call late one afternoon that they wanted me to be on World News with Peter Jennings that night to talk about whether or not President Reagan, who was running again, was too old to be president. So here's the context, so you'll understand about what you see. that was the fall campaign between Reagan and challenger Walter Mondale. And this was the first debate, and many of you will recall that in that first debate, in that fall campaign in 84, President Reagan performed very badly. He just seemed to be lost. He stumbled, he couldn't think straight. So very predictably, all the newspapers the next morning started to speculate front page stories as to whether or not he was too old to run. And so very predictably, all the evening news programs made that their lead story. And as I said, about 4:30 in the afternoon, I got a call from the executive producer of World News, a guy named Bill Lord, who I knew from Good Morning America Day, saying that they were going to have a report by Jim Wooten, and then they wanted me to be on the set with Peter and talk about whether or not he was. And I said to Bill, that's crazy. I can't do that. And he says, well, it says here you're available to us whenever we need you to talk about medical matters. And I said, Bill, I'm not sure this is a medical matter. And He finally talked me into it, and I remember like it was yesterday, walking across the street from the 2020 building to the World News building, thinking to myself, Johnson, you're going on national TV with an anchor you don't know, never met, talking about the President of the United States. You're out of your mind, right? So what you're about to see is a doctor out of his mind sitting on the set talking about this issue, and we'll just run it, and then I'll make a comment after. This is called entertainment.
Should age be a factor in determining leadership? In some countries, age, or at least longevity, can be an apparent prerequisite for high office. The Soviet Union is led by 73-year-old Konstantin Chernenko. China's Deng Xiaoping recently turned 80. Age has not been given much weight in American politics, but as we mentioned, the question of President Reagan's age may be taking on new significance in this campaign. Here's ABC's James Wooten.
This was one of those rare days in schizophrenic Washington when the whole town seemed to focus on one thing, Ronald Reagan's age. It all started with this morning's Wall Street Journal and a story that quoted Democratic Congressman Tony Coelho. He said the president himself had made his age a campaign issue by looking old and acting old in the debate on Sunday night. And when Speaker O'Neill, who's no college freshman himself, showed up for work today, he said he couldn't agree more.
He did look a little tired the other night, a little confused, which he admitted. Oh, sure, there's a factor. There's no question about it.
The question may be fairly simple. Is Mr. Reagan, the oldest man ever to serve as president, too old to serve four more years? Any suggestion that he may be understandably irritates the men who run the White House, but it isn't an entirely irrelevant question. Even some of his loyalists conceded that he didn't seem up to snuff in the debate.
The system is still where it was with regard to progressivity, as I've said.
And there have been other times when he hasn't seemed exactly on top of things.
Is there anything you can do to get them to the island?
Doing everything we can.
Doing everything we can.
Michael Deaver, his closest aide, has said the president falls asleep occasionally during cabinet meetings, as he seems to have drifted off in this audience with the Pope. Just one more of the endless round of appointments on any presidential calendar, a regimen that has taken its toll on much younger presidents in the past. So his schedule is liberal with rest and relaxation, and there are plenty of photo opportunities to show him as the picture of health, a hale and hearty president, no matter what his age. Most Democrats are still very cautious because the president's age is an issue with a lot of potential backlash. Jim Wooten, ABC News, Washington.
Well, that is the political dimension of the story today. To discuss the medical side of it a little more in depth, joining me is ABC's medical editor, Dr. Tim Johnson. Dr. Tim, if the some people in the audience did see the president more faltering, more uncertain, and looking old, does that really tell us anything?
I don't think so, Peter. I think one has to make a careful distinction between various aspects of aging. For example, there are problems associated with aging of the physical body. President Reagan appears to be in good physical health from all we can gather. There are other processes that might be more associated with changes in mental acuity, but even those do not necessarily signify aging. A person may, for example, have always stumbled while trying to think or speak on their feet, and what we're more interested in is any change for them. Finally, I think we have to say that there are other kinds of changes that have nothing to do with either physical ability or mental acuity, such skills as judgment and instinct and intuition.
Let me interrupt you for a second then. You're saying that if the president was halting and uncertain on the television, it is not necessarily a reflection on his ability in other areas.
Not necessarily, but obviously cause for concern. The only two statements I could make, medically speaking, that would not be challenged, I think, are these. Number one, that with increasing age, there is clearly an increased statistical risk for both physical and mental problems. 10% of people who reach 75 have significant mental impairment. Having said that, the other side of the medical coin is that there is no good way to predict in any individual case what's going to happen or how fast anything might happen.
The president said in the 1980 campaign that if he became president, he would take regular tests for mental agility, or as he called it then, senility. Is that something that he should do, or should any man 73 in that job do?
That does become both, I think, a medical and political question. We do not have precise medical tests to say that this person is suffering from aging attributable to mental change. But we do have some tests which, when taken together, can give some at least clues in that direction. I personally think that those are tests we would apply to anybody we suspected of having some mental problems or some aging associated with mentation, and maybe we should apply it to a president as we would to anybody else.
Dr. Tim Johnson, thank you very much.
You know what that's called?
Yes.
Waffling. Anyway, that was my baptism of fire, and I may not have looked too scared, but I'll tell you, I was really scared. So, at this time, as I started doing much more work in New York on a regular basis, many of my colleagues would start asking me to recommend a doctor for them in New York City. And I remember that I had this wonderful classmate and friend who I thought the world of and who I knew was a very smart man, John Olichney. And I had this vague recollection that he had come to New York City and was practicing in New York City. So I looked him up, found that he practiced on the West Side just a few blocks from ABC headquarters on the Upper West Side. And so neither of us can remember exactly when, but at one point I called him up and said, I want to come down and say hello and get to know you again. And we started talking, and I quickly realized that he was not only the wonderful human being I remembered, but a very, very bright doctor, a solo practitioner, internist slash hemonc. And to make a long story short, I started sending patients to him from ABC. And over the years, probably 40, 50 such people, including Peter Jennings that you just saw there. And that renewed our acquaintance and our relationship. And now I'm going to turn it over to John to tell you what he's been doing since 69 to that point.
Incidentally, Tim, I want to say that your obstetrics training didn't go to waste. That was a wonderful delivery. The kind of fun we have sometimes over the phone, sometimes in person. But my path went a different way, and I went a bit to Albany as to where I went to intern and do residency and fellowship. It was Roosevelt Hospital in New York, and one of the professors at Albany had mentioned to me that this was a very favored place to go, and I had interviewed at New York Hospital at Cornell and a few other places. I really liked Roosevelt. I was received by, at that time, Dr. Nicholas Christie, who was a wonderful man. He was the head of the endocrine boards, and he was the head of the, actually editor of the chapter of endocrinology and Cecil Loeb textbook. So Nick was a very weathered and bright man, but very, very warm and welcoming. And I found that as I met other people there, there was this kind of familiar feeling that I had at Albany, a warm, clinically oriented place, and that's really what I wanted. After I did my internship and residency, I did a fellowship with Dr. Harvey Weiss, and Harvey was become a patient and a good friend of mine. Harvey was the man who discovered aspirin as an antiplatelet agent, and we had the center of the experimentation with aspirin as far as coronary syndromes and the prevention in Roosevelt Hospital. So there was a lot going on in a clinically researched area, as well as a very wonderful orientation towards patients, again reminding me of Albany. I recall a few instances that were kind of interesting. John Waldenstrom, who was named Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, when I was a hematologist up at Columbia Presbyterian, I was asked to present a patient to him who had Bence-Jones proteinuria, and we had a wonderful discussion afterwards. These were the kind of people you interacted with. Dr. Benjamin Castleman, who I'm sure you know, the editor of the New England Journal, came and did grand rounds, and I was asked to present a patient with lupus erythematosus. And I did so, and at the end of the presentation, Dr. Castleman said, that was a fine presentation, Dr. Olichney, but are you telling us this patient had an autoimmune disease? And I said, yes, I think the criteria were filled. Certainly clinically it was that, as well as the serology of the anti-DNA and ANA nuclear antibodies were in place, so I felt that it really fit the category of lupus as an autoimmune disease. He said, well, let me tell you a story. When I was at the Mass General Emergency Room, a woman came in, and the history unfolded that she had been actually outside and walked across the street to get to the median. She was hit by a car, and she actually walked from the median to the other side and was hit by a car again. And when I looked at her in the emergency room, she actually looked pretty good, and that's the only case of documented autoimmune disease I've ever seen. Case at point, taken. So we had lots of fun. As I grew to like Roosevelt, I knew it was going to serve my purpose. I always wanted to be in individual practice. I guess I'm a little bit of a free spirit, and I never really liked being part of a hospital scene where, actually, there were certain restrictions in bureaucracy that just weren't, you know, kind of anathema to my liking. So I felt that it was a very good place to go because they did treat patients. There was a lot of clinical activity, and as a private physician, we did a lot of the teaching. We were part of the Columbia system, so we had Columbia medical students coming through. We had interns and residents, and of course, I taught the fellows in hematology. So there was a good spectrum of interaction with academic life, as well as being outside and having a whole clinical practice, about a fourth of whom came from Tim Johnson. But nevertheless, it was just interesting to see both aspects, because you can get very insular in medicine. Sometimes in the hospital, you see only... Yeah. Can you hear me? Sometimes in the hospital, you only see what goes on inside. There's an immense amount on the outside, which has different parameters and different guidelines. And so I really like the combination. I had options to go on staff. Barney Clarkson was the head of leukemia service at Sloan Kettering. He had asked me to join, and the people at Special Surgery had a dinner to invite me to be on staff. And each time I was tempted, but I said, I like this private practice. So I was on the IRB, and I was on a very interesting time because Mike Greco was there at that time, and he had the lead article on AZT in terms of treating AIDS. And, you know, the whole idea about taking the medicine and right on time. We had all the HIV patients getting up in the middle of the night with their alarm clocks and basically taking the pill at the right time. And it turns out that was important because as we furthered the number of medicines that we finally came to a regimen with three and four drugs that worked for HIV, it was very important to take them on time. The French in the early 2000s tried the holiday concept of taking people off the pills because of the side effects. Turns out people got a lot worse. So timing of the medicine was a very important thing. And I remember watching this, being on the IRB, I was responsible for the hematologic and oncology, as well as the HIV protocols. So thousands of protocols that I read over the years. And it was really interesting to see this thing evolve to a point where this totally fatal disease, all of a sudden, about 10 years, was basically now a chronic disease with which you could live as long as a normal person at this point. I remember Jeff Lawrence, a friend of mine who I helped with get his lab together. He was the head of the HIV immunology at New York Hospital. And Jeff went to the Geneva conference in 1998, and he called me right after coming back from that conference. He said, John, we have the medicines. This is still when people were dying of HIV. He said, it's about compliance. They were able to churn out the data to realize that people were now living quite long if they took their pills on time. So that set forth research and the drug companies to try to get 36 pills, which was the problem, into maybe 4 to 6 pills. So Sustiva was born from this, and Sustiva supplemented 12 pills. All of a sudden, people were living with a long, long life. So it was just that one item, you know, just the fact that there were too many pills for people to take, and ultimately, it really proved to change this disease, the whole horizon of this disease. That was a wonderful part of my experience in the IRB, but I was also on the blood bank committee. So even though I wasn't hospital employed, I was on the admission committee. So I did a lot of active things, and I really enjoyed it. There was other benefit to being in the middle of New York City, and as Tim says, just by chance alone, we met. And one was that we were close to Lincoln Center. As a result, I became the doctor of the School of American Ballet and saw all the famous ballerinas coming in my office. There was a lot of interesting people come through. And then we had, of course, the Philharmonic. And my partner, Dr. Albert Attia, was the doctor for the Philharmonic. And I would do a lot of consultations. And as a matter of fact, my most favorite consultation turned out to be my wife, Renee Siebert, who was actually one of the first women hired by the Philharmonic. I think Zubin Mehta hired her as the sixth woman in the New York Philharmonic. So my love of music was really manifest wonderfully. A lot of Benny's from being the doctor and being the husband of a Philharmonic member, because we used to go on tours, and one of the very interesting ones was being in North Korea. And we were in North Korea for 20 or 48 hours, actually, and getting off the plane in Pyongyang and having your cell phone taken away, having cameras taken away, being taken to a hotel on an island, going through this very dark and dank city with no lights at all. And when you get there, realizing you can't leave unless there was a minder with you, it showed the real reality of communism. A very good thing, an interesting thing happened during this tour. The Philharmonic played a folk song, which was really the folk song of the United Countries before Korea was separated into South and North Korea. And this really hit the hearts of the Koreans to a point where there were a few Koreans in the orchestra, and towards the end of this folk song being played, tears started to come down, you know? And then all of a sudden, the tears started to come down on the Koreans. All the communists were basically crying. And as the Philharmonic stopped and ended this concert, there was huge applause. And they started to walk off stage, and the Koreans were waving like this, no, come back, come back. They were waving them back. And I have to tell you, the emotional outburst of this thing in that audience, there wasn't a dry eye in the audience. It was really an amazing experience. One of the things, because we were the first Americans there in 50 years, was there were 50 television cameras all around from all different countries, and they wanted to interview anybody who could speak English. And I think I said it starts with the arts about 500 times, because you couldn't walk without being interviewed. They did film the concert, and I was in the audience, and I'm probably about a foot taller than the average Korean, and they all had the same suit, and they all had the same tie. They had a dark blue suit with a black tie and light blue shirts, and then there was me. And when I came back to New York, one of my patients had spotted me in the audience, and this very funny woman called me and said, Dr. Olichney, I saw you in the audience in North Korea. You were very brave to go to North Korea. I thought they would put you in jail for being too tall. Well, they didn't. And so I came back and then had the fun of another part of, stop me if I'm talking too long, Tim, but you took a long time yourself. So one other thing was my fun with the Mets, and of course, many of the people from the media that Tim sent, there were just lots of interesting friends that we came together. But I was a Mets doctor, too, from about 1982 to about 2002. So I went through two World Series. The most fun of all was when the Mets beat the Boston Red Sox. but it was a lot of fun. I mean, baseball is a very different sport. It's really the American sport. There's a lot of character in baseball. You have Casey at the bat. You have Casey Stengel. You have Yogi Berra and the Malpropisms. You have all these people who are Joe DiMaggio and their song, their folk songs. They're all, this was baseball. It's the real soul of the country. And I felt a lot of that when I was with the Mets. I'd go down to spring training every spring and befriend and take care of all the patients. And it wasn't just healthy people. I mean, we had testicular carcinoma in one of them. I diagnosed myeloma in one of them. We had kidney cancer. I diagnosed a tuberculoma in one of the famous pitchers' chest. It was a mass, and it turned out to be tuberculosis. And also David Cohen, the syndrome of throwing the ball. That was all my purview. So I saw a lot of interesting things medically, but the most interesting thing was the character of the people that I was with. And Bob Murphy, who was the voice of the Mets, he could create the game on the radio to make you feel like you're there. He really had a talent in this, and he's in the Hall of Fame now. And Bob and I were sitting next to each other on the plane going out to the West Coast. Mets would go out, play the teams in the West, San Francisco, Los Angeles, and then San Diego Padres. We would go in that order. And when we were on the plane, Bob told me a funny, cute story about when the Mets were first formed in 1962. Casey Stengel was the manager, and they were flying out to play the San Francisco Giants in Candlestick Park. Now, Candlestick Park was right next to the airport, so the winds were horrendous in Candlestick Park. And they got Casey on the field, and one of the announcers was interviewing him on television, and he said, Casey, how do you think your newly formed Mets are going to handle the winds in Candlestick Park? And Casey says, Christ, we're still working on the grounders, you know? Another cute story that Bob told me was about the Houston Astros. And Houston had a team that was founded just a little bit before the Mets. And the Astros basically were looking for a place to have spring training. And they looked in Arizona, and they looked, finally ended up finding a place in Florida, the town Kissimmee. And it was too late when they realized they would be called the Kissimmee Astros. But the most fun I had, am I up?
One more.
The most fun was really dealing with my patients, and particularly the old girls. They were so much fun. I mean, they had such a sense of humor. And I remember Sam, a man age 93, I was auscultating his heart. I was listening for about a minute, and all of a sudden I get this tap on my shoulder, and I hear him say, you hear any signs of life, you know? Or Jill, who I walked into this room, a 92-year-old one, and she was looking at this magazine. I said, good morning, Jill. And she said, Dr. Olichney, do you see this magazine? Do you notice that all of the articles on the front page, none of them have the page number, except this last one, which is entitled, How to Improve Your Life with Great Sex. And I turned to that page, and it was torn out. The fun that you have with people, you need time to have fun with patients. You can't be constricted to 12 minutes a patient. That was the freedom that I allowed myself by staying in private practice. And let me tell you, I had no such thing as burnout. I had no such thing as electronic disease, you know. And it was really a very, very pleasurable life, filled with the richness of being in New York and knowing my friend Tim, who kept sending, if I need a little extra cash, he'd send three patients. It was really good. Anyway, that's it.
And indeed, we connected because we both graduated from Albany Medical College. That's the reason I looked him up and found him and found a great doctor for my colleagues and friends at ABC. And we shared many wonderful experiences and still do over the years, including the fact that, as he said, one of his patients became his wife, and I was privileged to perform their ceremony now almost 11 years ago, right? Renee Siebert, flutist in the Philharmonic, who John had as a patient, and that evolved into a different kind of a relationship, obviously. So the four of us have had some wonderful times together. In my own case, I no longer took care of individual patients, obviously, but I had a sense always when I was on television, whatever the format, that I was really talking to a patient. People used to ask me, how do you feel when you're looking into that camera? And I said, I feel like I'm talking to my brother or my father or a friend. And one time on Good Morning America, I can't remember how it came up very unexpectedly, but Charlie Gibson, Charlie and I were and are very close friends, asked me live on television, so Tim, what do you think you really accomplished with what you're doing on television? And without really thinking, I kind of jokingly quickly said, well, I have some friends who think I do nothing but provide cheap entertainment for hypochondriacs, which made him laugh out loud and made me laugh out loud. But it was a comment that made me think a little more about what it is we do, those of us who are privileged to have access to the airways. And I would more thoughtfully and seriously answer that question than I did and now by saying simply, I think we tried to give good, accurate information to people so they could make better health decisions themselves. And that was certainly a great privilege. I mean, John and I will both say time and again to each other, we were in the golden era, the 70s, 80s, and 90s. John in medicine, myself in media, where we were given the opportunities to do things the right way and to try to do things for people in the right way in our respective careers. So we both look back on it and consider ourselves very, very fortunate. This is titled A Tale of Two Doctors. And I suppose we're riffing a little bit on the famous Charles Dickens book, A Tale of Two Cities, the 1859, I think it was published, about Paris and London at the time of the French Revolution. But I think we all remember from high school English, probably, the opening line of that book, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. And John, I would say we were in the best of
absolutely
times.
No question
about it, and I think many in this room would say the same thing. So we'll stop here now and see if you want to make comments or questions about what we've done or what you think about what's happening today, anything. This is a free-for-all discussion, but we'd welcome your comments and questions.
I just wanted to add something, Tim, before the questions. I wanted to add that Tim was very modest about the wedding, but Renee and I agreed that he held the best wedding ever in the world. And one of the things that Tim did, as he always liked to do when he married his friends, was he would take the first word of the first letter, that is, of the first name of the bride and groom. So Renee, the R word, he would think of a word that aptly describes her, and he really picked a beautiful one. He said, Renee Radiant. I thought that was a wonderful choice. And then it was time for him to come to the groom, and he said, Jay, and I said, Tim, don't say jerk, because he could have done that. But he passed that moment and actually said joyful, and I really appreciated it. At the end of the wedding, we had about 50 people in the Plaza Athenae, people were lots of friends of ours over the years, and Tim had us turn around and face the people who came to honor our marriage. And it was a wonderful moment of at least a minute where we were just looking at everybody and just interacting without words. And it was a especially unique kind of thing to do in a wedding. So I appreciate that so much that it was easily the best wedding ever in the history of weddings.
I did have the privilege of performing probably 60, 70 weddings for close friends and colleagues and family.
Now, and you did divinity school before medical?
Yes, I finished seminary, as many of my classmates know. I finished seminary before coming to medical school, so I started medical school at age 29. I thought I was the oldest in our class, but Pete, I think, assures me it was Bill Richards. It was a few years older. At any rate, and in our class of 69, as everybody here knows, in the class, we really had a wonderful group of people, a small class, 60 of us, and we got to know each other, and we had quite a few people who were coming in for second careers. We had three men who had been dentists before they came here, several older people who had gone another direction. So we had a wonderful group of people, and we really got to know each other very well. But one of the things I did at all the weddings, as John says, is, you know, most weddings, the congregation is there and the people stand here with their backs to them for the whole thing. So somewhere in the middle, I would always say, turn around, now look at this audience, look at your congregation, just memorize where they're sitting, your mother, father, relatives, friends. Just take some time to memorize this picture. And then maybe once a year on your wedding time, come back to this space and stand here and just look there and try to remember the people who were at your wedding. And I've done that for years as part of the wedding ceremony. Anyway, enough talk from us. Please, questions, whatever. Peter.
John, I liked what you said about clinical practice. I was one of the very...
Can you hear in the back? All right, good, yeah.
One of the very first, actually one of three very first family practice residents at a new program at the University of Colorado when I was in my internship and then residency. Mm-hmm. So it was a three-year program, and at the end of that program, I was asked by the director to stay on as a clinical faculty to teach the new residents as they came along. And it didn't make any sense to me for me to be teaching new physicians to go out and practice when I had never done that myself. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I turned them down and said, maybe I'll think about it in 5 or 10 years. But I went out and I joined a practice, became very active in the practice, and never once again thought about going back into teaching in a clinical setting. Yes. I was having so much fun dealing with patients face-to-face every day.
Yes.
I react to your same sentiment.
It's the joy of medicine, is people, is the connection, you know, the human aspect. Show me the computer that can give a patient hope. You know, show me the computer that can give compassion, empathy. Show me the computer that can actually clearly tell the patient what they have. It takes time to do this, you know. Sometimes you have to ask the same question three times to get an answer. This reminds me of Charlie Gibson. We interviewed Sarah Palin. We had a night with Charlie one time, and he was actually being accused, remember this, of badgering Sarah Palin when he was interviewing her when she was running for vice president. And he said, I wasn't really badgering her. He said, I was actually very impressed with her. I was very, very impressed with her as a person. And he was basically just trying to get the answer that he was looking for. You know, discourse and real getting accurate answer is not a simple thing. And we sometimes assume and we make mistakes. So we are much more capable of... You know, the computer is black and white. Medicine is shades of gray. And those are kind of immiscible to some degree. And we're trying to put the square peg in the round hole. And that's where I gave Tim an article on electronic medical records. It's a scathing article about where we really are. And I think you were pretty impressed with the level of it. We have to modify this a little bit. Medicine's been taken over by men in suits. We really have to modify this in a way that what we put in is cogent, relates to the problem. It doesn't have to be 17 pages to describe a nosebleed, you know, and I always say it this way. I say that these printouts you see that when a patient goes into the emergency room, you get 16 pages of garbage. And I said, it takes you so long to find the pith that by the time you finally find it, you're pithed off.
You agree, Peter?
Yeah, and of course, I didn't practice, but I was in contact constantly with my friends and colleagues in Boston, particularly at Mass General, who did, and I would hear constantly from them about it. As many of you might know, the partner to the healthcare system in Boston, which includes Mass General, Brigham and Women, and several other hospitals, put in the Epic system. Now it's about 5 years ago, is it, Steve?
Yeah.
And at a cost of $1.5 billion. And I have heard nothing but trouble from my generation. I don't know how you feel, Steve, but same thing, I would assume. Yeah. So there's going to have to be some recorrection and a readdressment of this whole issue, no question about it. Other questions or comments? Sure.
Dr. Johnson, if you were asked Peter Jennings' question today, or then, off camera, would you give a different answer?
Today about our current president?
You said that.
But I
asked, just in general.
I well, you know, the question would be related to a specific person, I presume.
Okay, well. Or about Ronald Reagan back then.
Yeah, and of course, what happened in 84, as you may recall, is he did perform very badly in that first debate, but then was fine in the next two debates. His staff said what happened in that first debate. He was overprepared. They worked him too hard, and he was not thinking very clearly that night. And he did do better and got reelected, as you know. I would tell you that I have been a part of a couple of panels recently in Boston about the role of the public and the press in evaluating presidential health. And it's become an issue in our current presidency, as we all know. And as we all know, there are some psychiatrists who are speaking out about President Trump's mental condition. We all know about the Goldwater rule, which says that psychiatrists should not comment on anybody they have not personally examined. But there are psychiatrists in the profession who are challenging that rule. I was on a panel recently with the editor of the Boston Globe and the chief of psychiatry at McLean's Hospital in Boston, big psychiatric hospital, and the tension between the privacy of the patient and the public's right to know is a very real tension when it comes to this kind of an issue. We concluded, our panel that day, that there ought to be a mechanism for independent evaluation of the health of presidents and maybe the two finalists in a presidential election. But it has to be apolitical. Maybe something done, for example, using a standard protocol at Walter Reed Hospital. It can't be, as the final word at least, Trump's personal physician in New York City who wrote that famous letter about the president being in the best health of anybody he'd ever seen, whatever. It has to be an independent process. Maybe we've come to a point because of that office and its importance in world affairs that we should have some independent method of evaluating candidates' health. That's going to be a matter of ongoing debate, and maybe we have an opinion here.
Just a minor comment on this. I agree with what you're saying, where I have hesitancies about Walter Reed, given the fact that Walter Reed is
financially controlled. Yeah, it probably shouldn't be Walter Reed for that reason, but we ought to be able to find a way of a truly independent assessment.
It's how you get psychiatrists to come down to firm decisions and agree.
Yeah.
If you have a, say you pick three or five, you have to pick an odd number. And then what happens if it's 3-2?
Yeah. Oh, no. There are all kinds of issues that would have to be worked out. And nobody pretends that we have the right answer, but it's worth talking about. And that's what I think we're having is a dialogue. Now, you know, you hear the discussion about how they would agree. I always think, remember President Truman's famous comment? He said it once when he was asked about economic advisors. He says, "I'm looking for a one-handed economist, so he can't say on the one hand and on the other." And I guess that's the hard part in any of these kinds of discussions, is finding a clear-cut objective opinion. Yes?
When you discuss the possibility of evaluation of someone for higher office, such as the president, there could be all kinds of good and rational and appropriate reasons for doing so. But then by extension, why not take other areas of importance, be it on a national basis, on a corporate basis, on an academic basis? And if we start looking as the health and projected health, and projected psychological state, projected neurologic cognitive state of an individual, we'd be open to a horrendous quagmire of discrimination by implication, rather than hiring or choosing based on abilities. All we're buying, when we buy a car, all we know is that we want to know the good health of the car at that very moment. Yeah. It does not mean it's not going to collapse within the first 100 miles.
There's no question that it could be a quagmire. On the other hand, as we all know, we already require stringent exams for certain categories, like pilots, for example. People who are doing very critical operations, we insist on very careful assessments. So there is a precedent for for doing it already in certain groups of people, but how far you extend that, big debate.
Dr.
Yes.
Olichney,
yes.
You worked with musicians,
yes.
Athletes, mm-hmm. dancers. These mm-hmm. are really high-performing people.
Yes, these are top performers. Yes.
How were they when it came to changes in their health care or accepting health care? I mean, did they share traits?
You know, the baseball players are a bunch of sort of, it's a lot of variation. Some of them are, you know, really very oriented towards health, and others are not so. And so baseball players were a little different from the ballerinas. Of course, the ballerinas, the problem was, and these are both men and female, I took care of all the big names over the years, was the dieting, the over, and there was one, I remember, a patient who was sent to me, can't mention her name, but she was a great ballerina, and I said to her one time, do you understand that your anorexia has led to a point of really close to fatality, you know? And she said, I said, you know, there's life after ballet. And she said, not to me, there isn't. And she died about 6 months later of anorexia.
Wow.
So there's this very strong, you know, push towards this weight control. As far as the other people, I think the media people are hopeless. I mean, you can't. And one of the questions I had actually of you, Tim, is, and I brought this up before, is that remember when we used to have Tim and some of the commentators talk about a topic like diabetes, and you would watch the show for a half an hour, and he'd have experts from Stanford and experts from maybe Harvard talk about the program. You'd learn something about the entity. It was a good, thorough program. And I said, Tim, now all you see on the media is 30-second news bites. That's all you see. Diabetes, blah, 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 and you hardly need to hear what they say. And it's not at all useful. And I asked him, why has it come to that level? And his answer was?
Money.
No, it was actually the answer was different. The answer was that the attention, the marketing actually realized that the attention span of the average American is now 30 seconds. That's our electronic world. And that's why you have bits. You don't have these long things.
And
money is something, but you had better answer that way.
Well, and that's very true. Yeah. When I joined ABC News full-time in 1984, there were only three networks then, ABC, NBC, CBS. At 6:30 in the evening, news time, 95% of the American population was tuned into one of those three programs. 95%. Today, if you take those three plus CNN and Fox as five news channels that are on 24/7, at 6:30 at night, about 24% of the Americans are watching one of those five. So the marketplace has become completely splintered. That's resulted in intense competition. And that's resulted in appealing to the low attention deficit span of modern viewers. And that's because the more viewers you get, the more money you make. So it's a completely different ballgame in the media market today than when I joined. And that's why I say I was so, so fortunate, Peter.
Although I would add to that the news programs that are touted as being news programs,
yeah.
such as a trial on somebody's for murder, that
right.
is what 2020 or what,
yeah.
all those other programs
yeah.
that are touted as news that are really not news
no,
at all.
They're not news anymore. 2020, when I was part of ABC, was a great program. We were given time to do thorough, complete reports, thoughtful reports. It's just a different ballgame now. Now, I suppose we just sound like two old farts up here complaining, but I really think objectively there's been a very real change in so many of these things, including the news media.
Sandy, I should add, when you ask about the different people to deal with baseball, of course, we had major problems in baseball with drugs. We had the very well-publicized Doc Gooden and Daryl Strawberry thing, and I was involved in that, of course, because as the doctor of the Mets, we had to monitor those things. But we weren't allowed to actually take their bloods. It was in the National League contract that you couldn't take bloods for testosterone levels or for drugs. So our hands were a bit tied. We did funny things behind the scene to try to protect ourselves, but that was one thing. And, of course, the steroids. And the Mitchell Commission called me because of this rampant use of androgens. You know, baseball has changed a little bit. Everybody likes the long ball. It used to be nice squeeze bunts and plays where you would run and have a quick game. Now everybody wants to do the long ball. So they're using testosterone and lots of weights to get stronger so they can hit the long ball. So the androgens are now the big problem. And I think that it's pretty hard. They can be disguised. And, you know, this is lots of millions of dollars they're making. And if they do it and somebody else doesn't do it, that guy's at a disadvantage. So a lot of pressure on them to take these steroids, androgenics.
Well, I think we have run out of time. I'm going to make this closing comment, which is, I think everyone in this room, and certainly John and I would say this, had no idea what was going to happen when we left here in 1969. Just unbelievable how our lives took different pathways. And so whenever I talk to groups of young people, especially young medical students today, I always say to them something like, I know you're sitting here thinking you've got your whole life figured out. You know what you want to go into, where you're going to go for your residency, and where you're going to go practice. iLife illustrates the fact that you have no idea what's going to happen. So I always say to them, in your blueprint of life, leave the big section marked TBA, to be announced, because you don't know what's coming. And wouldn't we all say that? Thanks for listening.